Thanks for joining us today. This event is brought to you by Data Talks Club, which is a community of people who love data. We have weekly events, and today is one of such events. So on Tuesdays, we have webinars. On Fridays, we have live interviews. So go to our website, which is datatalksclub/events, to find out more about the events. This Friday, we will talk about switching careers from physics, doing physics in academia, to doing machine learning in healthcare. So check it out. Then to stay up to date with all our events, you can subscribe to our newsletter, join our Slack, and subscribe to this channel. And during our chat today, during the presentation today, you can ask any question you want. You go for that, you click on the pinned link. It will bring you to Slido, and there you can ask any question. And last thing, I know that many people are watching these events in the recording after the event happened. If you have any questions to Agnes that you want to ask when you watch, you can do this by going to events Q&A channel. You can ask your question there. And I asked Agnes to keep an eye on this channel for a couple of days. And that's it. So Agnes, the floor is yours.
Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So, hi, welcome everyone. So, this talk will be about setting up an A/B testing framework. So, brief overview of the contents. I will first give some general introduction about A/B testing and myself. Then I'll cover metrics, or basically deciding what to measure. Thereafter, I'll briefly talk about data transformation that you need to do before testing. Then I'll cover testing, in particular, the t-test versus alternatives. Thereafter, I'll talk a bit briefly about when to stop the experiment, which in our case is done with some minimum sample size calculation. And finally, I'll briefly touch upon user adoption and end with some summary. So a brief recap of what A/B testing actually is. So you have some platform or website, and you have a bunch of users, and you want to add some feature to your platform and see how people react to it. So what you do is you you assign users to two variants, one in version A, one in version B. Version A is the current state of your platform, and version B is the one with the feature. Then you collect user data from both groups, and in the end, you analyze this data and you yield some conclusions which variant is better. And in this talk, we'll mainly concern ourselves with the last part, so basically the stuff in the image below the red dotted line. So why should you care about this at all? So A/B testing is irrelevant always when you have to optimize some task or evaluate some task in terms of human satisfaction. So for example, for e-commerce, it will be clicks on items, replies to items, or purchases. And yeah, in the area of machine learning, this is particularly relevant when you want to evaluate models like recommender systems or personalized ranking models. More generally speaking, it can also be used to evaluate any kind of user interface change. And it's also quite relevant for online advertising. For example, if you present people with ads based on some targeting model, then you want to make a distinction between the selection or targeting effect versus the advertising effect. Simply put, it might be said that it might be the case that the users that you targeted would have gone to the website that you advertised for anyway. So you want to explicitly separate between these two effects. I've added a link to some paper here, by the way, at the bottom, and I will share the slides later so you can read upon the references later yourself. Then there are some topics related to A/B testing that we'll cover in this talk that are also relevant in other situations, like when you have to get labeled samples for evaluating a model, for example, model for image classification or named entity recognition, or if you want to measure the user's satisfaction with some surveys, then you also need to do some sample size estimation, and you probably want to know what kind of test you can best apply to see if the results are significant. And yeah, topics like that I will also cover in this talk. So briefly about me, so I have a background in artificial intelligence and I mostly have experience with recommendation, search ranking and natural language processing. I currently work at HeyJobs in Berlin, and before that I worked at OLX Group where I developed their internal A/B testing framework. And I was also working in the search and recommendation team at OLX, where we regularly used that framework to evaluate our models. So most of my experience in this talk actually comes from working there. And before that, I worked in Amsterdam as a search R&D lead and also as a data scientist. So briefly give an introduction about OLX and why and how we did A/B testing. So basically OLX is a global online marketplace where you can sell and buy stuff, usually second-hand stuff, where there are like thousands of users every hour. So on the right side, you see an image of interface of OLX in mobile view. So in this example, I'm searching for ice skates and I get a bunch of results from people that want to sell their ice skates. So as you can imagine, some example topics that you want to test in this case are, for example, new models for ranking results, models for recommending results to users, and also general user interface changes. So any A/B test follows basically between subjects design, where, as I mentioned before, you have variant A, also called the baseline, which is basically your current platform, also called the control group. And then you have variant B, which is the platform with a specific feature, like a new ranking model. And this is also called the treatment group. Of course, you can have more than two variants. In the example on the right, you see a screenshot from this A/B testing framework where we basically put 50% of all users in the entire experiment, but then the experiment has like three variants and each of them gets 33% of the users allocated to it. Of course, there are some requirements when assigning users to variants. I think the most important one is consistency. So users that see a specific variant of your site or platform, they shouldn't be presented with a different variant of the site during the experiment. And then there's also accountability, where you need to keep track of the number of users in each variant for statistical purposes. Again, on the right, you see an example of an experiment with two variants where you have a 50-50 division in terms of control group versus treatment group. So I won't cover the topic of user assignment in great detail, but I can say the following about it. If you assign users to variants, you can basically do it in two main ways. So if you have very few users, you can store the assignment logic per user. And this way you have a very detailed control over the assignment allocations, which might be difficult, might be important if you have few users. It's also easy to add sort of cohorts. So to say, okay, in this particular variant, I want to have only new users, for example, or maybe you want to have for every variant exactly as many regular users as new users. But yeah, if you have a lot of users, then this is can be prohibitively heavy to store all those assignments per user, and also can quickly get complicated if you have a lot of experiments. So in that case, you can store the assignment logic per experiment, per variant. So one example could be that per experiment, per variant, you have some finite list of codes somewhere. So for example, you have all three character combinations of hexadecimal characters, which in total are about 4,000 combinations. And you give each experiment and variant a subset of them. And then to assign users, you take the first three, you take basically the hash of their user ID, and then you take the first three characters of that hash of the user ID, and then you assign them to the experiment and variant that matches with those first three characters. So in this way, you can do very quick and online experiment assignment based on the user. Okay, so next I'll briefly cover what to measure. So in our case, all the metrics were based on the so-called conversion rate, which is a classical marketing KPI, but you can basically express any metric with it. So the conversion rate consists of a so-called base value or visit, which is the page visit to the site necessary for conversion. And then you have the actual conversion, which is the action that you're interested in, like the purchase or download. And then you have the conversion rate, which is basically the conversion divided by the base value. And that's why they're also called numerator and denominator. So for example, if you want to measure the number of responses to seen ads, then as a base value, you would have the number of visits to that ad, and as conversion, we would have the number of, okay, this example is not correct. If you want to measure the number of purchases after a visit, then as base value would have the number of visits, and as conversion, the number of purchases after a visit, and then the conversion rate would be those two values divided. And I think it's pretty obvious why you would want to do this, because it could be that one of your variants has a fewer number of visits for some reason, but you still want to have a fair comparison of the number of purchases after a visit. So that's why you do this division. And it's important to note that the conversion rate is a final single number and not calculated per user. So it's the sum of all the numerator values for all users divided by the sum of all denominator values for all users. And it's usually done this way because you're interested in the total success in the end and not the success normalized per user. So here I outlined that in a bit more detail with this example, just to show that these two concepts are different. So here you have variant E, A in yellow, and variant B in blue. So if you calculate the conversion rate, then you just sum all the conversions for A, and you divide it by the sum of all the base values for A, and then you get 0.5. If you then do the same for variant B, you get 1/3. So here A is higher than B, so A is the winner. But if you would divide the conversion by the base value per user and then sum it and then compare, then you get a different winner, then B is the winner. So just to be clear, we're interested in the top metric. And now you might think, okay, but how do I test this value? Because it's just a single number. For example, if you would apply a t-test, then you need the variance, right, of your measurements. And if you would apply the Mann-Whitney U-test, which is Another commonly used non-parametric test, then you need a list of rankable samples per variant, which you don't have if you have a single number, and we'll cover that later, so stay tuned. About the metrics, I also want to briefly mention that it's not very helpful to display the two conversion rates side by side. You're mostly interested in how well a variant performs compared to the control group or to the baseline. So we express that in terms of the uplift, and the uplift is basically just the conversion rate of a variant divided by the conversion rate of the control, minus the conversion rate of the control divided by the conversion rate of the control times 100 to make it a percentage. So basically how much better the variant is than the control. And here you see an example from the interface at OLX for the uplift. So you see that variant B is about 1.7% better than the control group for this metric, and variant C is about 6% better than the control group for this metric. Also, usually you're interested in a single metric, right? Predominantly, but just including a single primary metric is a bad idea for two reasons. First, because I usually have some conversion funnel on your platform. For example, you just go to some landing page, then they browse items, say add an item to the cart, and then they check out. And usually also at each successive step, there are fewer users who complete them. But if you are testing a certain feature, then you might want to know where exactly in this conversion funnel some possible drop happens. So it's useful to include metrics that cover this conversion funnel so that you can see if there's a suspicious drop somewhere, because then you also know that you can easily debug what's going on. But it also gives you insights in at what point exactly of the conversion funnel your feature is better. And secondly, if you only include one or a few metrics, then you can get accidental deterioration on the metrics that you ignored. And particularly, different teams might care about different metrics. So just some example, maybe your change increases the number of ads that people browse, so you're happy because that's what you wanted to optimize. But it could be that your change makes it harder for people to create an ad. And if there are some other team that's responsible for that, then they won't be very happy when they find that out later. So it's good to include multiple metrics for that reason. So at OLX, what we did is that there were always included certain standard health metrics that basically should never decrease. These were included in every experiment by default, and they were designed so that they cover this funnel and are aligned with basically the global company goals. So this secures against this deterioration with respect to the company goals. So in the bottom right, you see some example. In the bottom row, you see the primary metric, which is conversion from a job seeker to a job replier. This was for the jobs vertical. And you see there's a 1.7% increase in terms of uplift, and it's green, which means that it's significant. But you also see two rows above it, there's some health metric called ad views for all users, which decreased, and it decreased significantly, which is what the red color indicates. So in this case, this feature that we are testing here wouldn't be rolled out to all users because there was an important health metric where there was found to be a significant deterioration. So now I'll briefly cover data transformation. So recall that for our metrics, we are interested in the conversion rate, which is the sum of all the numerator values per user or the conversion values per user divided by the sum of the denominator values for all users, also called the base values or the visits. And so as data transformation, what you probably want to do is you want to remove the data points where the denominator or base value is zero, because then there is no visit. It is supposed to happen before the conversions, so it doesn't make any sense, and you want to remove those. And you also want to remove outliers, and thereafter you want to feed the data to some statistical test. But now the question is, okay, how do you do that? Because you only have this single ratio value, and for a certain variant of the t-test, you would need the variance. And for the man with new test, you need a list of ranked samples. So the solution to this, as is usually done, is something called linearization. And it's based on Taylor approximations. In our case, of the Taylor approximation of the function x divided by I. And just as a quick refresher or introduction to Taylor expansions. So the Taylor expansion or the Taylor series of a function is basically a sum of terms expressed in terms of the function's derivatives. And it is defined at the single point. So if we have this function with two variables, then it will be defined at a single point A and B. And the Taylor series basically is an approximation of the actual function. And it will be roughly equal to that function. How much depends on the so-called degree. But it will anyway be equal to that function at the point AB where it was defined. Mm-hmm. So in the bottom right, you can see an example of a very basic Taylor series. In this case, it relates to the cosinus function, and the Taylor series is approximated at the point zero, so where x is zero. And the blue line is the original cosinus function. And then you see that the orange line is the basically the first order Taylor approximation. And you can see it's horizontal, completely horizontal. So it's not a very good approximation, but it is exactly equal to the original function at point zero. And then you can see if you add more terms, which is basically how long the sum of terms is, then it becomes more equal to the original function. So the green line is already more equal to cosinus, the red line even more, etc. So why is this relevant to us? Basically, doing this, using this Taylor approximation logic, we can express the conversion rate through our as a single list of samples. So recall we're interested in this function x divided by I, and the conversion rate is basically this function little f applied to the sum of capital X and the sum of capital I, where the capital X are the numerators and capital I are the denominators. Now if we make a Taylor expansion of this function through the points AB, where AB are the sum of capital X and the sum of capital I, then you get back a single list or vector Z. And the important point is that for this list, so for the result of the Taylor expansion, it has the same mean as the original function. And also it usually has the same variance as the original function. So in our case, it means that we have two lists. So we have the pair variant, we have numerators and denominators, and we feed it to this Taylor expansion function, then we get back a single list. And if we take the mean of that, then it's the same as the mean of this conversion rate, and also the variance is the same. I've added some references at the bottom that probably can explain it better than I do now. But I can say that I've done a lot of simulations with this, and it proves that the mean is indeed practically always the same, and the variance is closely approximating the real variance. The better, the more samples you have. So now we have pair variant. We have a single list that we can easily feed to the t-test or the Man with New test or any other test. So then the next step you want to do is outlier removal. Well, in terms of outlier removal, in the case where you have some online platform, you probably want to do some pre-filtering, like remove data from site crawlers, etc. But that's not really what I mean with outlier removal. So I mean more automatic outlier removal based on idiosyncrasies in the distribution. So first, what we did at OLX is we check what kind of data or distribution we actually have. So if we only have binary data, so only ones and zeros, then we don't remove any outliers, because in that case, you don't really have outliers. And in the other case, where we don't have binary data, but we have more continuous data, then we use a combination of how many standard deviations a certain point is away from the mean, and also a certain minimum and maximum percentage. And in this case, it's actually important to set a hard maximum percentage of points that you remove, just in case people might think they get weird results from their test because you remove too many data points or something like that. But if you then have a hard maximum, you can always say, no, that's not possible because we only remove, let's say, 0.5% of your data. So now to the actual testing. I think one of the most commonly used tests for between subjects design is the t-test. Yeah, so basically you have the student's t-test, which has some assumptions like the means of the data should be normally distributed, and also there should be approximately equal variance in the control and variant groups. And then you also have the Welch's t-test, which is basically the same, but it drops this equal variance assumption. But still, you have this assumption that the means of the data are normally distributed. And in our case, we had some doubts about this, if this assumption would be met, because a lot of our data that we got from experiments was actually extremely right skewed, so had a very long tail. And you can also intuitively see why this would be the case. It's because many users simply do very few actions or no action. So on the bottom left, you see a fairly normal distribution, and then on the bottom right, you see more like a typical distribution on our experiments. And on the top right, you see with the black lines, basically the average of 16 random control data from experiments. Again, you can see there's a very heavy tail to the right. So it doesn't really look normal at all. So now I'm sort of obliged to say that there is the central limit theorem that says that for any distribution, then the distribution of the mean will eventually be a normal distribution. So in this example, on the bottom left, you have some log normal distribution, which clearly isn't normally distributed. But then if you take about 100 samples of it, each time you sample 30 data points, and then you take the mean, and then you plot the mean, and then you do that 100 times, then you still get something that looks quite normal. So that's also why people say that, okay, in theory, you can always apply the t-test, because eventually, if you have enough samples, it will be a normally distributed mean. But I think the keyword here is eventually, because it sort of depends on the shape of your distribution. So yeah, I took this these screenshots from some blog posts, which are also linked below. So on the left, you have the original distribution, which is also clearly not normal and skewed. And then if you take about 10,000 samples of size 3 and you plot their means, and you get the thing on the right, which still isn't very normally distributed. Again, if you do the same, then with a sample size of 10, and you plot the means of 10,000 of such samples, then you get the graph on the left, which is already looking a bit more normal, but still not extremely so. It's only when you increase the sample size to 100 that you can see that the mean is actually normally distributed. So yeah, there's a lot of literature on this, and it seems that the consensus is that, yeah, for moderately large samples, the t-test is kind of robust to light violations of normality. And however, the t-test may be underpowered, which means that it's less likely to reject a false null hypothesis if the data is asymmetric, in other words, skewed, and the sample size is not large enough. And in this latter case, often another test, the Mann-Whitney-U test, is suggested. Anyway, it still sounds a bit vague to me. So we did some simulation study where we compared the t-test with the Mann-Whitney-U test. So first, a brief introduction on the Mann-Whitney-U test. Like I said, it's a non-parametric test, so it doesn't have this normality assumption. It just checks if two samples come from different distributions. And it checks basically how likely it is that a randomly picked value from variant A, it's greater than or lesser than a randomly picked value from variant B. And it's often used as an alternative for the t-test. So what we did is we examined the power of the two tests for data with varying skewness. And again, the power is the probability that the test rejects the null hypothesis in the case that the alternative hypothesis is true. So you want that value to be high. Maybe I'll skip this slide because of time constraints. But the point is that we tested about 36 different types of gamma distributions, all with varying skewness. And then we took a sample from each of these distributions. We got the p-value and checked if it was below the significance threshold, which it should be because we picked a sample such that there was a clear uplift. And then we got these results that sort of illustrate the average. So on the horizontal axis, you see basically what corresponds to the standard deviation, and on the vertical axis, what corresponds to the skewness. And in the squares, the average power is plotted. And what you can see that if the skewness is quite low, or similar to a normal distribution, then the t-test is performing just as well or better than the Mann-Whitney-U test. But if the skewness increases, then the Mann-Whitney-U test actually has a higher power on average. So for our framework, we decided to basically go with the Mann-Whitney-U test in case the skewness or the asymmetry exceeded some threshold. Yeah, and then maybe I'll briefly cover some other tests. So as I mentioned, we also have binary data in case it makes more sense to apply a chi-square test. You can see example of a binary data in some contingency table on the right. So basically, if you also only have zeros and ones per variant, then it makes totally sense to do the chi-square test. Or if you have very few samples, then it makes more sense to do the Fisher's exact test, but they're basically applied in the same situations. So to summarize our flow, if you have binary data and enough samples, you do the chi-square test, else the Fisher's exact test. And if you have continuous data, then if it's normal enough, we do either the Student-Seed test or Relativity test, depending on if the variance of the control and treatment group are equal, and else we do the Mann-Whitney-U test. We also did a bootstrap test to deal with continuous data with a very small sample size. So basically, in this case, you take a lot of samples with replacement, but you edit them so that the means between the control and variant group are equal, so that the null hypothesis is true. And then you run the t-test, you record the result, so the t-value, you repeat it a lot of times, and then the final p-value will be the fraction of times the result from all these simulations was more extreme than the result you get for the actual observed data. So if this is high, then the result is not significant. So basically, if it's low, it means that your observed data were quite extreme, and therefore it's significant. And we found that this approach can be better than the Mann-Whitney-U test for in the case where you have very small samples, though it depends a bit on the underlying distribution, and it worked best for us when we first transformed the data using some summarization method, namely the Geo-Johnson method. I don't think I have a lot of time left, but maybe I can briefly cover the minimum sample size calculation we had. Yeah. So in our setup, we basically get new data continuously, and then we run the statistical part of the engine every night. So a question to ask is, okay, when do we know how to stop the experiment, and when can we say that we have enough data to say that the test result is valid? And there's some standard calculation for the t-test that depends on various factors. So the first factor it depends on is the minimum detectable effect. So if you can express it in terms of this uplift from before, it just has the minimal percentage of change you want to detect. So the minimum uplift. And basically the lower this effect is, the higher the sample size needs to be. And it's usually set to 1%, which is also what we did. But basically it's a settable thing. So you can set it higher if you want to have a lower minimum sample size. And then there's also the significance level. It's just the chance of rejecting the null hypothesis when it's actually true, which is not what you want. So you want to set this thing low. It's usually set to 5%, which also means that your confidence interval is 95%. And then there's also the power, which we discussed before, is the chance of rejecting the null hypothesis when it's actually false. So you want this thing to be high, and we set it to 80%, which is also quite common. And then the final factor which you cannot set or control is the population variance. Basically, the higher the variance of your data, the higher the sample size needs to be. There are some methods to reduce variance, but I won't go into that now. So then you have a final calculation like this. And basically, it's based on this book, which I added here as reference. But the important part to notice here that the numerators, you have to set alpha and set beta, which represent the significance level and the power. Then you have the standard deviation. And then in the denominator, you have the targeted mean of the alternative hypothesis minus the mean of the control or zero hypothesis. So this is basically the minimum detectable effect in the denominator. And then this is also more intuitive description from that book. So maybe I'll leave it out to make the presentation a bit shorter, but yeah, I recommend checking the references. And there's also other minimum sample size calculations. So you have the one for chi-square test, but it basically reduces to the same one, well, almost the same one for the t-test. because the choice square test for binary data is equal to binomial tests, and the binomial distribution can be approximated by a normal distribution. And for the MetaMedNew test, we used one from the paper mentioned here. I recommend checking it out. I also have a Python library for non-parametric tests in general. It's a bit different than the ones for the t-test and chi-square test because it doesn't use minimum detectable effect or significance level or power. And finally, I want to briefly touch upon user adoption. This is more like a soft topic, so to say. But user adoption can be a big hurdle if you want to roll out some A/B testing framework, because teams usually already have their own ways of experimenting and analyzing results. So some possible felicitations that I would say that you can do are, first, it's nice to have this standard way of expressing metrics, and that you can have this numerator denominator framework, and then also allow for custom metrics through SQL queries, for example, so that people can always include the metrics that they that they are used to experimenting with, or that they want to experiment with. Secondly, it's important to give some clear conclusions. Like at OLX, we had a positive conclusion, negative conclusion. There was also a waiting state for when you're waiting for more data to make a conclusion. And there's also an inconclusive end result. Then we had some thing called experimentation ambassadors and internal courses. And these are basically these ambassadors. Ambassadors were basically people that sort of hovered over different departments, helping them out and motivating them to do experimentation, and also giving some demos and tutorials how to do it. Then you can also embed experimentation in your routine. So let's say that, for example, after standup, you can always examine some experiments, or you can regularly talk about them in demos if you do weekly demos with your team. So sort of making it a routine to look at the results and think about the results as presented in this framework. And finally, of course, you need to have some good documentation and support channels. And that brings me to the end of this talk. So to give a summary, I would say that it's nice to have a clear framework for expressing metrics to allow for scalability in this aspect. Also, I would always include one primary metric, but also a range of health metrics. I would say it's nice to standardize the pre-processing and data transformation so that it's also the same for every experiment. So I've covered this linearization and outlier removal. Then I would say it's kind of useful to think about when to apply which test, also because every test has a different sample size calculation. So it might really reduce the running time of your experiment if you apply a different test, because then fewer samples might be needed. Then I think it's nice to formalize the stopping criterion. In our case, we did this with this minimum sample size calculation. And finally, it's of course good to have a nice, to give nice, clear, reportable results, like for example, this uplift metric, and some conclusion, like you could go further and also introduce confidence intervals and stuff like that. It's up to you, but I think it's nice to have some clear sets of results that are basically always reported. Yeah, and that brings me to the end of this talk. Thank you for listening.
Yeah, thanks Agnes for your presentation. So I just want to remind that you can ask a question by going to live channel, and there is a pinned link. You click on this and you can ask any question you want. And we already have a question about ambassadors. The question is, were these ambassadors early adopters, and what is your experience in recruiting those people within different teams in the organization?
I was an ambassador myself, and I also didn't recruit them, but I can say that they weren't really early adopters in the sense that they weren't just, you know, people from a team that started to use the framework, but they were really they were for example product owners of the entire framework for a certain department. So this was really their main role, and I can imagine if you don't have a very large organization, then this might not be very practical. So in that case, I think it can totally make sense to use early adopters. But I would say it's important that they know the needs and the wants of sort of the people they try to get into this experimentation mindset.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. Another question we have is, did you set up any kind of testing on monitoring on this of these systems? And if so, what type of things did you test or monitor?
That's a good point. In terms of this statistical part, we didn't set up monitoring, though it was something that we wanted to do and we thought about. What we did have is that we kept the data from all historical experiments, and we very regularly reused that historical data for simulations, or for example, for seeing what kind of outlier removal approach makes sense. We tried it on a lot of data from historical experiments.
Thank you. I have a question myself as well. So maybe I think you said that, but I might have missed it. What is the purpose of linearizations? Why do we want to do this? What's the rationale behind it?
Okay, I'm sorry if it wasn't very clear. So usually when you have a test, right? Like the man-with-the-U test, you need to give it input. So you give it as input the data from the control group and the data from the variant group, right? So these are basically two lists. So every group should be represented by one list or vector. The purpose of linearization is to transform this conversion rate metric to this vector.
So, because I think, like, if we just take, so we have some conversion rates, so we divide one thing by another, right? But what are the cases when it doesn't work? What are the cases when we cannot just, let's say, take the number of people who visited the page, take the number of people who bought something, and just divide one by another? So in which cases will it make sense to actually do this linearization?
Well, it's basically like this example, right? Is that what you mean?
I think I stopped sharing your screen, sorry, so people can see our faces. So you need to start sharing again. No, like the like this thing with Taylor expansion and the that yeah, exactly. Like I was trying to understand what is the purpose of doing this. Why we cannot just divide one by another and call it a day.
But okay, so but divide one by another. What do you mean exactly? Because
well, let's say we have we want to track the conversion rate, right? The number of people who bought the who bought something divided by the number of people who visited our page, right? So we have this simple case. And we want to test like if a green button gets more conversion than the red one. It doesn't matter. So in which case we need to do this data transformation?
Well, in the case where you have a test where you need to input a vector of data points, right, for each group. So for example, if you have a t-test, then you actually only care about the means. So then you wouldn't have to do it. But for other tests, yeah, you would have to do it, at least if you want to test this conversion method.
Okay, so it depends on the type of metric we have, right?
Yeah, but all our metrics are basically expressed to this conversion rate. So this is also quite common. So you always have the sum of the numerators for all users divided by the sum of the denominators for all users. So in that sense, the metric doesn't really matter a lot, but you could in theory also do the t-test by only comparing means, and the mean of this ratio is basically the ratio itself, so you wouldn't need to do any linearization.
Thank you. Yeah, we got a few more questions in the meantime. So one of the questions is, how long are the A/B tests? So how long do they run, and how big the sample size and the like the for the variants and the control groups?
That's an interesting question. Actually, that varies a lot between what you're testing and also where you are testing it. In the case of OLX, like we had our platform in various countries, and naturally, for some countries there were far fewer users than for other countries. So then the same metric with the same test, it takes a lot longer to compute or to reach the minimum sample size. But I would say that usually it was something like 2 weeks. If you look at larger countries, in our case, Poland or all the countries together.
So the answer is it depends, right?
It depends, yes. But if it would be like months, then I would have, you know, investigated different approaches for testing.
Okay, thank you. Maybe I think it's easier if I just share my screen so you can also read the questions.
Sure.
Yeah, so the you mentioned that you use the conversion rate method, but when I should consider following the not conversion rate approach?
I think you should decide for that yourself. In our case, we did this because it aligns with our business goals. So we don't really care about, how do you say, the average value of some metric per user or normalized per user, but we care about the overall improvement. I think that if you think it's important to normalize per user or to maybe not users, but some other entities you have in your platform or system, because that aligns with your business goals, then yeah, you should do that. I didn't cover that approach because it's naturally far simpler. You don't need to do any data transformation for that. But it's not a common approach. But yeah, if it aligns with your business goals, then yeah, you can do that, of course.
So is there a link for the entire session available? Yes, there will be a link. We'll put this in the description with the slides shortly after the stream today. Can you differentiate in details the difference between MDE and Uplift? So what is MDE, by the way?
Yeah. The Uplift is basically the percentage of change of the variant compared relative to the control group, right? And then the MDA, it's the same kind of metric. So it's also the percentage of change, but it's basically in a different context. It's basically the percentage of change that you want to see. It's measuring, the measuring unit is the same thing, right? So the MBA is also measured in terms of the same relative percentage, so the same as the Uplift. It's just that, let's say that your MBA is 1%, then it means that you detect a positive uplift of 1% or higher, but also an uplift of -1% or lower. If that makes sense. Because, yeah, it's basically the size of the effect you want to be able to detect. And this effect can, in reality, of course, be positive or negative.
So one thing you set up up front before even running the experiment, right? And the other is the result of what you see.
Yeah, I think that's right? Also a good way to put it. The MDE is indeed something that you set before doing the experiment and it will influence your minimum sample size. But the Uplift is just something, it's part of your result and it will change every day.
So what are the reasons to build your own A-B testing platform versus using something existing like Optimizely or something else?
Very good question. I didn't decide this myself at OLX. Unfortunately, I don't have any insider info there. Imagine that it has some benefits in the sense of, for example, in our case, some constants or some techniques that we use for example, outlier removal are really tailored to our data and our type of platform. So I think that's a very nice advantage. And then, of course, you have the usual advantage in the sense that if people want some feature or if something needs to be fixed, then it's far quicker to do usually if you have it in-house.
Yeah, thank you. Do you, by the way, know any existing tools or maybe there are open source tools? So one is Optimizely. I imagine that there are some other tools that are also paid or open source. Do you know any of such tools?
I don't have them on the top of my head, but I know there are several I don't have any top of my head.
Okay.
I know there are multiple ones. I think Optimizely is really targeting large businesses, but there are also obviously smaller companies that are making tools for smaller businesses.
Yeah, I think this one I think we can quickly close because we answer that we did implement this thing at OLX, so we didn't use existing tool for that. Am I correct? I can post this one.
How to estimate the budget. Yeah, I think
no, no, I'm talking about this one. So
okay.
We go to the budget one.
Oh yeah, about the user interface. No, I didn't implement it myself. We had front-end engineers and software engineers doing that. And I was mainly concerned with the statistical part of the code. But yeah, we did have some product owner that aligned this, of course, all between us. I think it was made in Vue, the front end, but I'm not 100% sure.
But, basically, the answer is yes. So we did implement the whole thing ourselves. So do you have more time now to answer some questions? Maybe we can take a couple of more if you have time and then answer the rest in Slack.
Is sure, okay? I can stay for a while.
So how to estimate the budget for performing one A-B test? I don't know if budget, what kind of budget means here. Do you have some ideas?
I think the budget is heavily correlated with the minimum sample size, right? So with the duration of your experiment. And also another thing that may play a role is the how large your variants are. So how many users you allocate in there, because if you have a very, if you have a very risky feature so that it can be perform very badly, then you might lose profit with regard to all the people that were assigned to that variant.
Okay, so budget in this sense. Okay. So do you know what PET data is?
No.
Okay, so maybe it's possible for those who ask this question, it's possible to edit the question. Maybe you can add a couple of more details what PET is. So we'll take the next one. When we calculate minimum sample size, does this mean our experiment should run until this many users took part in each variant?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Because if we don't, then we don't know the results, right? It can be, well, maybe it's not statistically significant, right? And then we cannot say for sure that, okay, this is indeed like better or worse or whatever, right? So how do you define when a feature change is worth an A-B test in terms of time or resources?
That's a good question. I don't have a general rule for this, but I would say that it's usually the case when getting manually labeled data would clearly be very cost intensive, or wouldn't even measure the right thing. So for example, for recommendation algorithms, you can just get a bunch of people that label your data. You would really have to test it on your platform.
And sometimes there is simply no alternative, right? So if you want to run something, you have to make sure that users like it.
Yes. So
for some cases, you don't have other options. I guess we just have two more. I think it won't take too much time if you're okay with that. So was the conversion rate higher in the test group in your used case? Yeah, I guess like it depends on the case, right? So do you want to answer that?
Yeah, I don't really follow any case, I think, in my presentation. So, and the answer is it depends.
Yeah, so like for each case, some cases are rejected, some cases are, like in some cases it's better, in some cases not. So a question from Nikhil. Can A-B testing negatively affect SEO? Search engine optimization, I assume.
To be honest, I think it depends on what you're testing. So yeah, I'm not a SEO expert, but if you are testing two landing pages with different SEO keywords, then I would say yes, it can negatively affect it if you're online testing some variant that is clearly performing worse or better. But that's all I can say about it in the context of SEO.
Yeah, so depending on whatever version Google picks up, you can either get lucky or not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's all the questions we had. I think there are some in the chat, but I will put them in Slack.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, thanks a lot for joining us today, for sharing your experience with us. And mm-hmm. thanks everyone for joining and watching the stream today. And yeah, so thanks, Agnes.
You're welcome.
And see you on Friday when we have another event. So.